And now, those of you that are here and those that are at home, if you're in a sitting position, put both feet flat on the floor or your ankles crossed, whichever is most comfortable to you. And we're going to take a few moments to work upon the health of our bodies. Each and every week, we go through many, many different emotions, feelings, thoughts, etc. And we always want to be at the very, very best that we can be optimally as we start a new week. So let your eyes close, if you would, and just take a few moments to think along with me. I turn away from the outer world that surrounds me to center in on the inner world of my own mind, soul, and spirit. And as I do, to focus in upon that healing presence, that presence that has created me, that presence that has sustained me each and every moment throughout my life. For it is as if the universe has individualized itself in me, clothed my soul in this physical form, this body that I wear in this lifetime. And so let me feel that from the very innermost part of my being, this creator, this reality, exists in me as an inner light, a light that is within me and yet a light that is infinitely beyond me. And so from this inner light, let me feel that the health of my body can be influenced. For all of the energies that comprise my physical body have come forth from this one primal light energy of the universe, this consciousness that is God within myself. And so let me think of my physical body from the top of my head, down the length of my body to the soles of my feet. Let me think of it as a millions and millions and millions of cells, each with an energy factor, and that entering each one of the cells at the very center of my beingness is energy, the light energy of the universe, moving in every one of the millions of cells of my body, both outwardly and inwardly, adjusting, restoring the energy factor within each and every cell. From the top of my head down the length of my body to the soles of my feet, all of the cells of every internal organ of my body being adjusted, renewed, regenerated through the healing light presence of the infinite, of God here within myself. For my body is God's temple, God's church, God's cathedral, the place where God lives in me. And thus I accept that the greatest presence of consciousness, of mind, and of reality within me wants my body whole, well, and complete, so that the infinite may express, God express, through the finite body, the human body. And therefore I accept that my body is perfect, even as God within my body is perfect. That my body is an outer radiation and manifestation of perfect life, God energy. And as I feel this, let me think that this also exists in all levels of my mind, conscious and unconscious. That whatever is in need of healing, mentally, physically, and spiritually, is in a process of continuing birth and rebirth renewal, and health. For this realization, this day, and every day of my life, I give thanks to the God Presence, the Creator of the universe, who lives in me, the Creator's creation. Our subject this morning deals with telepathic energy, telepathic love energy in your life. There is a constant interplay between all of us. We can't escape each other. That's about the way to look at it. We can't escape each other. Now, some might say, well, why would we want to escape each other? There may be moments that people have something taking place outwardly that they don't find particularly attractive in another person and want to get away from them. At the same time, there is a telepathic type of situation that takes place between people, which will cause people either to be attracted to that person or repelled by that person. Over the years of practicing meditation myself in deeper levels of consciousness and having worked with and researched the consciousness of literally tens of thousands of students that I've had over the years, I have found definitely that there is this interplay on an unconscious level between people. There is more said and done between yourself and another person on what is not said, what is not seen, than what is said and what is seen. Psychologists estimate that 90% of our decision-making consciously is under the influence of whatever is in the memory bank of our minds, our subconscious. Therefore, if our conscious decision-making is so much under the influence of our unconscious mind, and our unconscious mind is part of the interplay that we have with other people, then it is that between ourselves and others, there is this interplay of consciousness taking place continually. When it comes to love, very, very definitely. Love, after all, is the greatest of all things. We can, with it, feel very, very good, and without it, we can feel very, very bad. It doesn't matter what any tests that we might have medically say to us. The medical tests may all show up in a very, very optimistic way, but if we're not feeling love in our life, if we're empty and void of love, then the body tends to break down, our communications with others tend to break down, so it affects us financially and it affects us in a personal sense. I think the greatest gift that we have as human beings is love. I mean that in all sincerity. I feel that people that strive for fame and power and so forth is just to try to get into a better position, that maybe they might be able to attract love. Look, I'm king. Would you like to love me? You can share the throne on the other side here. This is the way that people seem to grasp out towards love. At the same time, they can be repelling it through their very actions. I know people that are in this world that are takers. And takers are always shy of love. Any of you ever noticed that? Yeah. Takers are shy of love. Why? Because a taker is a selfish person. A person who just wants to get, and not give. And selfishness is a negative energy vibration. So if a person is selfish, they're sending out this negative energy vibration. Telepathically, we're a sending and a receiving station, each and every one of us. We function through a universal medium of primal energy or God energy. Each of us contains a light within ourselves, and that light is the transference of the medium of thought and thought energy and feeling energy. Whatever you think or you feel travels out through the universal medium of cosmic consciousness, God mind, Christ consciousness, however you choose semantically to refer to it, that is going out continually. So if you have love in your life, it means good thoughts are going out. Now, what are good thoughts? Good thoughts don't necessarily have to revolve around love. Good thoughts can revolve around anything that is positive, because positiveness and love energy are basically one and the same. I know people that walk around life with a frown on their face, and they don't have any love in their life. You've all seen the pictures of that they have in drama of the smiling person and the frowning person. Well, to me, a lot of people walk around with this big frown, not necessarily on their face all the time, but within their heart. If you could open up their heart, here would be this frowning person, the person that continually will see that the glass is half empty rather than half full. And if you think this, what do you bring to the table? What are you projecting out? I'm an empty person. I'm not half empty. I'm not half full, I'm half empty. Therefore, when you come to me, you're only going to get emptiness. That's going to be what I'm sending out. And then there are people that just simply choose to create drama in their life. There's the good guys and the bad guys. The good guys and the bad guys, this dualistic type of philosophy that they go through life with. And when you have a house divided against itself, what kind of people will you attract for love? If you're sending out vibrations and energies of love, you're going to attract neurotic people. You're going to attract people that are not whole. And I'm not just saying as far as personal love is concerned. I know that the greatest neurotics, their friends are neurotics. It's as if nobody else wants them. So they have to get together just to preserve themselves. So you have a bunch of neurotics getting together with a queen bee or a king bee neurotic type of person, and everybody has their little circle of neurosis. Only you can make a choice as to how you want to live your life, as a fool or as a person of wisdom, as a lonely person or a person that has love in their life. Love is the most precious of all things. Why step on it? Where does love come from? It's a law of physics. Something can't come from nothing. In theology, we attribute God as being love, but why should we? I mean, some theology simply says God is this great big old guy up there, even older than me, just with his big lightning bolt, ready to strike the next person who does something that doesn't please this God. But the saying on the other side of their mouth comes, God is love. So you have almost neurotic theologians splitting up and causing God to be a schizophrenic. Am I making sense to you here? So if God is a schizophrenic, then it's portrayed by those that are portraying different things. Because a person is involved with religion means nothing. It doesn't mean that they're a person of God. Absolutely not. Last night I saw a thing about one person that's claiming to be the reincarnation of Jesus. He's got a huge following. A huge following. People are donating millions to this guy. Holy man. Convict, ex-convict, and heroin dealer. And yet the people are flocking because two angels appeared to him and said, Jesus is going to incarnate through you. Do you understand the stupidity that is brought forth in the name of religion? All you have to do is to make wild and absurd claims, and that's it. Well, you know, anybody that would have a pure enough soul to have a Christ in heaven has never dealt drugs, I can assure you that, has never dealt drugs. Never. But people throw love because people cannot see the goodness in themselves, so they try to create false messiahs. False messiahs to come and to save them from themselves. Now, when we look at love, we look at love then as a constant flow between ourselves and other people. Hopefully that flow comes from something that is pure in our heart. If you feel that there's something wrong with love in your life, there's nothing wrong with love. There's something wrong with you. It's as simple as that. The time that we accept responsibility, we personally accept responsibility for what is going on love in our lives, that is the first time that we have an inkling of maybe getting back on track and having love in our life. You cannot fill yourself with mental and emotional garbage, vibrate this out telepathically, and expect to attract to you other than people whose mental state is in a garbage can. You get your own act cleaned up. That means more than taking a shower. It means cleaning yourself from the inside. Until we clean ourselves from the inside, we can be filthy. And that filth goes out and it attracts only the same back to us. The people that one would want to have in their life as far as love are repelled. If, on the other hand, you feel that love is good in your life, then you must have gotten yourself cleaned up. You must be internally pure. Let's look at today's affirmations. The verse says, thought energy. It says, I understand that every thought I think is energy. Not every other thought, but every thought. Every thought that I'm thinking is an energy thought. The body is an energy field. Our emotions are energies. Our thoughts are energy. In fact, the whole of this universe is just one big energy field. Then it says, feeling energy. I understand that every emotion I feel is energy. For many, many years, in what we call the new thought field, the emphasis has been upon the idea that thoughts are things and thoughts are energies and so forth, and there is this effect of them. But also we have to think of our feelings. When we feel something, that is an emotion, and the emotion, in order to feel it, is an energy. So we're sending forth telepathically not just what we're thinking, but what we're feeling. If you're thinking negative thoughts, those are going out. If you're thinking or feeling negative feelings, those are going out. So constantly you are going and sending out. You are a broadcasting station that goes not just on this planet, but it goes throughout the universe. Why? Because we are one, each and every one of us, at the center of our mind, one with universal mind. That is not confined to time and space. And therefore, millions of light years away, somebody in their unconscious hears you. They hear you as a nasty, vile person or as a loving, beautiful person. They hear you as a taker who is selfish, or they hear you as a giver, and givers are loving people. Then it says love. I understand that all thought and feelings of love are energy. When you're feeling love, when you're really feeling it, you're feeling it throughout your body, you're feeling it throughout your mind. It's almost as if you're in a point of interior intoxication, as it were. It's a beautiful feeling. Any of you who have ever felt love, you know exactly what I'm talking about. It is tremendous. It heals us. It makes us feel optimistic. It motivates us. It is the greatest thing we can have going for us in the human experience. It is really God. The closer that we get to God within ourselves in higher states of consciousness and meditation, the more we experience this love as wholeness and allness within higher realms of consciousness. As we experience this, we more radiate this out to other people telepathically. They come into the sphere of your aura, they feel that love. They think about you, they think about you in a good way. It doesn't say necessarily that the person says, oh, that's a loving person, but they could just simply translate it, that's a good person, fine person. When you have this feeling that love is energy and God, then you think of it, well, where does it come from? And it comes from primal energy. In Hinduism, as an example, they refer to it as prana, the first energy, the first cause, the primal energy of the universe. And there was one quotation I remember when I was very, very young in this whole field that I thought about. It said, he who controls prana controls the universe. He who controls the life force of all things controls all things. Now, I don't want anybody to be in control of anything other than their own beingness, because you're the individualization of that one pranic energy. In other words, some schools of mental thought and mental manipulation, some idiot authors will write books like, you can control others' thoughts. Oh, come on. How infantile. The moment that a person says something like that, it shows me that they haven't even got into the sandbox of spirituality. Not even to the sandbox. We are not in this to control other people. So now, as I'm talking about love being telepathic, don't anybody get into their minds that if you have somebody that you have a love interest in, that you're going to light a candle, burn incense, you know, do some mantras or whatever else. She loves me, he loves me, she loves me, he loves me, she loves me, he loves me. No, no, no. You cannot take the kingdom of heaven by force, nor do you want to try to influence anybody to love you. The moment you try to create love out of manipulation, whether it's face-to-face or whether it's mental manipulation, you're the loser. You've already lost. Forget it. You might as well pack up and leave and go elsewhere. You already have lost. There's no point to it. Love has to happen naturally. It has to happen without force. How can it happen naturally and without force? It's destined. Think about that. How can love happen without manipulation and without force? There's only one explanation. It's destined. It was meant to be. It has already happened in the mind of God. It has happened in the consciousness of the universe. It was meant to be. I hope that makes some sense to you. So therefore, if you think to yourself, well, if I start just thinking loving thoughts about this person or that person, they're going to catch them in the air, and finally they're going to wake up and say, hey, I'm available. It doesn't work this way. You cannot force anyone to love you. But you can become so loving that suddenly one day they awaken and feel this attraction to you. And what are they feeling an attraction to? The perfection of God within you that's manifesting this loving type of energy through you. Universal mind, I understand that primal energy is the first creation of God or Christ's light energy. God manifests unmanifest as spirit. God then begins the manifestation of the universe in physical form. First is the primal energy from which all energy will come, and then thus all varying forms of matter based on those various energy factors. And hence, all things, including love energy, come from this one light, this one created part of God. Love, energy, God, energy. Universal mind, it says, I understand that the primal energy is the first creation of God, or the Christ light energy. The telepathic medium, I understand that all energy moves within the primal light energy from one creation to another. I'm a creation, you're a creation. All that you see around you are creations. So that light energy moves through each and every one of us. It connects us. We can't see it with our physical senses, but if we get into a high enough state of meditation, then every one of you that I'm looking at here, physically here this morning, sitting in your chairs, you're like a stream of light. At the very core of your being, each leg as it sits down on the side of the chair there, every leg is a stream of light. Your arms, your fingers, streams of light. You're a light being, in essence. And that is the medium through which thought travels, because all of us are totally connected. We are one light throughout the universe. Telepathy, then, whatever love energy I think or feel, travels through the medium of primal Christ light energy. 24/7. I understand that whether I'm awake or asleep, my love energy thoughts and feelings are being broadcast out telepathically. So you say, well, I'm going to get a good night's sleep. And what do you take to bed with you? If you have really bad feelings inside of you, what kind of dreams do you think you'll have? Just use common sense. If you have a lot of bad feelings inside of you, what kind of dreams will you have? You'll have nightmares. You'll have very, very ugly dreams. As you're having these nightmarish dreams, those nightmarish dreams are all energies. Everything that you're seeing, every image that you see as a dream image during sleep is an energy factor within your mind. Those energy factors travel out. So it isn't just your conscious thinking or conscious feelings that is traveling out. When you go to sleep at night, whatever nightmarish, gross image that you have, that you're dreaming as a nightmarish type thing, this is also going out ad infinitum. It is going out throughout the universe. You are broadcasting out the ugliness that is inside of you. You say, no, I'm dreaming about bad people. How do those bad people get into you? What power are you giving negativity in your mind? What power are you giving evil in your mind? You know, it's like the hell and damnation preacher. He's talking more the devil and bad and sin and corruption and so forth, and the people that are sitting there listening to that week after week, what kind of energy are they going to be left with? They're going to become the very thing, as the Bible said, what I have feared most has come unto me. Because the more you know, it's the idea of advertising. There's a very flippant idea of advertising in this world. Hey, it doesn't matter whether what they're saying is good or bad, at least we're making a front page. All of you know that. Doesn't matter whether it's good or bad, we're getting the attention. That's the kind of world we live in. So inside of ourselves, even when we dream at night, if we are having vile, gross things, I ask you to examine your conscious mind when you are awake. What kind of vile things are you thinking that is stoking the fires of hell, as it were, in your dream episodes? The more the purity of God's love is inside of you, where you see all people as having this within, even the worst and the most corrupt. And that's difficult to do. But if a person is really a Jesus-like mind, that's how they see it. If a person is so engaged in the good and the bad, the guys with the white hats, the guys with the black hats, the world is just one big smorgasbord of hate and evil and good and bad and ugliness and this and that. If you just see this as what we're here at, then that's the way it is. We're projecting forth our own mirrored image, each and every one of us, of what this thing is that we call life. All of you, at the core of your being, are universal. All of you at the core of your being are the manifestation of God. All of you at the core of who and what you are. All of you, therefore, are loving beings. All of you are the energy of love. All of you should be radiating out this love. But you can't simply say this on the surface, and don't think because you read a holy book, you read a Bible, or you read a Quran, or you read this, or you read that, that that makes you on the favor of God. No. You can use that. You can use that in a negative way to declare war on your neighbor next door or on a neighboring country. In the name of God, so many corrupt souls, as all of you know, have marched armies causing havoc in this world. We have to start with ourselves. If each and every one of us just takes time and meditates each and every day, even for 15, 20 minutes, we come into contact with that oneness. When people, mystics through the ages, when they experience the wholeness and the oneness of God, to a soul, they're saying, I'm experienced. What I experienced was this tremendous feeling of love, this wholeness, this completeness of love. I can't put it any other way. And then if day after day you're doing this and you come out of a state of meditation, you're not seeing this world in a vile type of way. You're not declaring war on other people continually. When you meet somebody, it's not what you see in front of you, it's by the character of the person. It makes no difference who or what they are, where they're from. It's what's inside of each and every one of us that matters. When we become loving in a universal sense, that's when we attract love in the whole sense to ourselves individually and personally. So if you're empty of love in your life, and you've heard me say to you, if you've been in more than once, to meditate upon this presence of wholeness and allness and God within yourself, you will radiate out love. That love will be there, and it will come out in different ways. It will come out where you're joyful, you're laughing. I was on the phone with one of the representatives from Wells Fargo a couple of days ago, And I said whatever it was divinely inspired to say a few humorous things. And towards the end of the conversation, he says, you know, I really don't want to get off the phone with you because you have the most infectious laugh I have ever heard. I said, I've been told that all my life. Where does that kind of laugh come from? It comes from this idea that God is a laugher. When I go into a state of meditation, I'm in that energy, so I feel the humor of things. I feel life. And yes, it may be entertaining, but it's coming from the heart. Whatever you want as love in your life has to come from the heart. 24/7 then, whether you're awake or you're asleep, it makes no difference, you're still sending out. So be extra cautious what you're thinking. If you have a bad feeling about somebody when you're going to sleep at night, just say, I release them into God's love. I release them. If I can't find love towards them, I release them into God's love. Don't take hate. Don't take bad feelings into yourself as you go to sleep. And then during the daytime, please, please, the moment you think some type of negative thought, stomp on it. Annihilate it, because you're sending it out. You think a negative thought, I immediately annihilate that thought. I neutralize that thought through the God light inside of me. I crush that thought here, now. I sublimate it. Because if you don't, it goes back into your subconscious mind, and then like a telepathic broadcasting station, you're sending it out. And people that you could have a nice love relationship with are running as far as they can away from you. And the only ones that are coming towards you are those that have this foulness inside of themselves, and you don't want them. Any of the men here want to foul women? Any of the women here want to foul man? If you do, you got trouble in River City with a capital T. Telepathic love reception. Now, how about if you're sending something out? What happens on the other end, on the receiving end? What happens on your end if somebody's sending out? I understand that love energy thoughts and feelings may be received consciously or unconsciously. What does that mean? It means that if somebody is thinking loving thoughts to you and sending them your way, you may pick up on them. Just the same way as if somebody is sending bad thoughts, you may pick up on. Anybody ever pick up without the person being in front of you that somebody was thinking either good or bad about you? Let me see, just by a show of hands, good or bad. You know then exactly what I'm talking about. It's a feeling that comes over you. You know, consciously or unconsciously. So that's energy that you're picking up. So I understand that love energy thoughts and feelings may be received consciously or unconsciously by all of humanity, as well as specific people, and may be accepted or rejected according to the karma or God's will active in them in this lifetime. So if you're thinking really good thoughts about somebody, some specific person, it depends upon what's going on in you and going on in them according to karma and according to God's will for both of you. Whether there's going to be the beginning of a love connection, a maintaining of a love connection, or the ending of a love connection. That's the way life works. The only thing that lasts forever as far as love is concerned is God's love. As hard a pill as that is to swallow, that's the reality. We enter this life with God's love as a part of our being. We exit this life with God's love as a part of our being. The only love that really endures is God's love. And hence, those of you that put love as a priority in your life, and I know some of you do, then get as close to God as you can. Things change. People come into our lives, people leave our lives. But this coming, this going, this changing of the guard within human life is the way that life simply is. The closer that we are to that love which never dies, the more that we're one with that love, the more we'll see ourselves through the barren times of love in this physical life. If you're feeling love when you go into a state of meditation and you come out of it feeling love, even if there's no personal love interest in your life at that moment, you'll still feel good. You'll still feel love. And after all, whether it's a person or whether it's spirit, it's what we feel that most counts. Meditation, through my daily practice of meditation, I establish and maintain a greater oneness with the ultimate absolute God love energy. That is what it is. Sometimes I've thought to myself, as I've grown older over the years, and as I've witnessed people that maybe are a few years older than myself, maybe they'll end up in some type of care center, senior center, whatever. Some of these souls, everybody that they knew has maybe passed on, their friends, their relatives, and so forth. And it's a very interesting situation. Far beyond, when I say interesting, beyond the clinical concept of the whole situation. Because if any of you have ever gone into a senior's home or care center and so forth, there are a few souls in each one of these centers that have absolutely nobody left on earth for them. And as maybe if you walk in to visit somebody and you pass one of them, they'll reach out. Some of you are nodding your heads. I see you've been there. They'll reach out. And what are they reaching out for? A bit of love. A minute, just the smallest smattering of somebody saw me. And so I project, and I say to myself, if I were ever to be in that situation, nobody around, everybody I know has gone either to the next world already or has traveled elsewhere, but I know that I would still be feeling love. And I know I would still be laughing. Why? Because I would pass the time with God as I have for all of these years, meditating, just simply being in that inner light. So when the time comes that the last heartbeat physically takes place, that I'm already where I'm going. We don't have to wait till that moment. We don't have to wait till our final moments on this earth. We can do it now. Each and every one of us can do it now. We can take those precious moments in this hectic world that just seems to be getting more and more and more out of control as foolish people attempt to run it. The world will remain as it is. I remember a song that I was when I was growing up as a kid. The words, I won't try to sing it. That would be not so good. The world's just the same. You'll never change it. So find yourself somebody to love. Well, immediately you think to yourself, I've got to find, well, if that's the case, I got better find somebody, you know, I'll look in the want ads or whatever. No, to find somebody to love is to find this presence of God loving you within. Not some delusional fantasy that somebody that can't find love in this life will escape into and cause some type of narcissistic spiritual experience. But rather, the reality of what every sage and seer and mystic, and they don't have an exclusive on it. Nobody has an exclusive on God. Nobody has an exclusive on love that is God. So inside of yourself, here and now. Jesus tried to emphasize this to his following. He said, the kingdom of heaven is here and now, which in essence meant the kingdom of love. The kingdom of God's love is here and it's now. And knock upon the doorway of your mind and your heart, and it will be open to you. Seek it within yourself, and you'll find it there. It's always been there. It's always been a part of you. You are a part of it, inseparable. And in meditation, we find that God love energy. And finally, God love as energy. The more God love energy is active in me, the more I telepathically send it out to others, which attracts and maintains more love in my life. Every time you meditate, you're sending out love. And it's going to attract love back to you. And if you want more love in your life, just think of what you bring to the table as far as personal love. There's a part of Corinthians, what is love? It's kindness, it's kind, it's gives the whole breakdown of what love is. And yet I know people that want love so desperately in their life or want some particular person to love them so desperately. And all I can think of is, what can I get? How can I control? How can I manipulate? Not what I can give. So you ask yourself, am I a giver or am I a taker? Jesus gave, Mother Teresa gave, Gandhi gave, they all the great ones were givers. All the tyrants have always been takers. Let each of your souls be saintly and light. Let your eyes close for a few moments and meditate upon that. I turn away from the outer world and outer sense impressions to turn to the inner world, the endless world of mind and of consciousness, of soul and of spirit, to walk down the steps of my mind through the mental corridors of consciousness within myself, to travel through realms of awareness that were entered into by all of the holy people, the sacred ones down through the ages. To enter that holy of holies within myself, to seek it out as a light center of consciousness, of mind and of spirit, without beginning and without ending, here within myself. For there is a spark of the infinite and the eternal within me that blazes as an inner light within me and yet infinitely beyond me. And so as I turn my senses inward, I turn my senses into that light, to sense that light, to feel that light, to be one with that light. And as I am one, to feel the allness and unity of life universal, and to feel that unity as love, where all things are one, where all things are joined together, where there is no sense of separation, only a sense of unity, of wholeness and of completeness, of all that comprise the virtues of that which is love. That energy I seek within myself. That godliness, that wholeness, that completeness. I seek it within, to be one with God's love, one with God's wholeness and completeness, one with God's mind, one with wisdom, to take whatever is ungodly or unholy within my thoughts or feeling nature, and to allow the light of God here within me to sublimate those darkened energies into light. Divine Father, Mother, God of the universe, in the Christed part of my mind, sublimate the unholy into the godly, the foolish into wisdom, the grasping into giving, let me be beautiful in my soul. Let my soul be as a lotus blossom unfolding in a field of your light. Let the petals of love vibrate their energy throughout my being. I rest in the peace of your grace, your power that is love. I rest in it for a few moments quietly, that I may, when I open my eyes again to the outside world and the senses, to be deeply one with retaining the sense of allness and of love within myself. So slowly, I'll begin to open my eyes, retaining that inner feeling within myself. And as I do, I'll stretch my arms and my hands high over my head. And I do this in a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars of the heavens, of universal life, mind, and spirit, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. And I bring down my hands, resting in the peace that this is so, and so it is.